Hi everyone. In today's video, I want to talk about anonymous inner classes within Java. For the newer Java programmers, this can often be a little bit intimidating to learn about, but I promise it's not as bad as it sounds. All that an anonymous inner class is an inner class that wants to remain anonymous. Who would have thought, right? What you can think of it as is basically an inner class that doesn't have any sort of name associated with it because it's only used one time. Let's pull up IntelliJ and demonstrate what that means. Today's project we'll just call anonymous. So now we've got IntelliJ up. The first thing I want to do is I want to remind everyone what an inner class is. So an inner class is one which would have a definition either within the context of the class itself or within the method that it's getting used in. So here's one example. All right, so what I have here is I've got a class that is within my main class here, and I'm calling it from a static context actually. So this isn't actually an inner class because inner classes are associated with object context. This case, I'm looking at a static nested class. So slightly different, but similar type concept where I've got a class defined within a class. Now I'm gonna go ahead and change this to be an inner class defined within my main method. All right, so now I've got an inner class, which is defined within my main method, very similar syntax, except this time now I don't need to use the static keyword because I'm using the class all within the context of my method here, and I'm not using it within a static context directly. I'll just go ahead and run this to demonstrate that it's working as expected. All right, so as expected, we declare the class myClass, we make an instance of it, and then we call the doSomething method, which prints out this string of the console, which is what we see here. So this looks as well about what we would expect. Now, let's say that we wanted to make this a little more complicated and we wanted to have a subclass implementation of another class defined as an inner class within here. Stay with me for a second. Let me go ahead and write some code so I can explain what I'm talking about. So let's say that I have an interface called my interface. And then I'm gonna give it another method called doSomething. And now I want my class to implement my interface. And whoops, I gotta add public here. That's actually a small little thing with access modifiers. Whenever you're overriding something, you've gotta give it more access than it originally had. So I had to put in the public keyword right there. So that aside, so now what I have going on is I have this my interface interface. And I've got my class, which implements my interface, and then I'm overriding doSomething. And my code overall doesn't change here, but the point being is that this is getting to be a fair amount of code. And if I want to do this in a way that requires less code, I can do that with anonymous classes. So to do that, what you do is you make an instance of the interface or the parent class that you want to use. So we're gonna say my interface, we'll just call it anonymous. And then this is really strange. We're gonna create a new instance of an interface, which you never probably thought you'd see that, huh? But really all we're doing is we're creating a new instance of a subclass for our interface, but we're not actually giving that subclass a name. It's gonna stay anonymous. And it's gonna get defined within these brackets here. So what we wanna do is we move that implementation down, and now we no longer need this class declaration. And basically what we have here is now I'm just gonna move this to here. And that is an anonymous inner class. What we have is we have the new operator over our interface, and then we define the methods that we have to overwrite for our interface within here. And then we call something on it. That's really the gist of anonymous inner classes. There are a few caveats, and I'll get into those here in a second. Before I get to that though, I want to talk about why this is grayed out. If I hover over this, IntelliJ is asking if I want to create a lambda instead here. I'm not going to do that in this case because going over both anonymous inner classes and lambdas in the same video I think would be too much. So I'm going to have a video about lambdas in the future. Be sure to check that one out when it comes out. So back to anonymous classes. Let's say that I want to add another method in here. I'm going to say doSomething to. Now you'll see that I've got an error here because I have to implement my unimplemented methods. I'm gonna go ahead and click OK. And then this time I'm gonna say doing something to, and this will just be doing something. And then now I want to say anonymous do something and anonymous do something too. Go ahead and run this code and make sure this works. Excellent. So as expected, I can go ahead and call methods on my variable here because my variable is an anonymous inner class that is a subclass of the myInterface interface. So now I'm going to go into another case where you see anonymous inner classes a lot, and that's when you pass an anonymous inner class in as a parameter to a method. So I'm going to write a method that takes a runnable, which is an interface with one method, the run method, and it's used in multi-threading, which I'll get into here in a few videos shortly. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to pass in an anonymous inner class that implements the runnable interface to a method and then have the method call run on that runnable. All right, so here's that code. So what I'm doing is I'm calling the do something method, and the do something method requires a runnable. So what I'm doing is I'm creating a subclass of the runnable interface, and I'm doing it anonymously so that I don't have to have a random class called my one off runnable. Instead, I get to just do it anonymously right here, and I get to specify what I want in the run method and when I run the code. You'll see that first what happens is we enter the do something method, and then we call the run method, which is defined here, and we call this print line function, and then we hit in the runnable. So another couple things about anonymous inner classes. Like other inner classes, they can capture variables. And what I mean by that is when a variable is either final or what's called effectively final, you can have that variable used in your anonymous inner class. So I'm going to say int my variable, I'm going to give it a value of 10. And what I can do is I can say my variable equals my variable. You'll notice here that this compiles very interestingly. It also compiles if I throw the final keyword in front of it, and that would be my strong recommendation as far as when you are documenting what goes in anonymous inner classes or in lambda expressions for that matter. I really like to be explicit and say which variables could go into them and mark them as final, because the whole point of an anonymous inner class or related type of functionality is, since it's capturing the state of what's around it at the time of when you create it, you need to make sure that your variable value doesn't change three lines later, because then now you've got the wrong state in your method where you captured the variable originally. So I'm gonna go ahead and demonstrate this working. We can see here that we've captured the value of my variable and it equals 10. Similarly, if I were to get rid of the final here, this is what's considered effectively final, which was a concept added in Java 8. What effectively final means is that at compile time, whether the final keyword is present or not, the compiler will determine if the assignment of the variable changes, and if it doesn't, then it is considered effectively final if it isn't already marked as final. And effectively final variables can also be included, and that's why this code compiles. But you'll notice, if I then go and change my variable later, now the code no longer compiles, and it says it's accessed from within an inner class, and it needs to be final or effectively final. So again, just to reiterate why this doesn't work, let's say that I had a non-final variable and it had a value of 10. What value would it print out here by the time it gets down here? Think about that for a second. Would it print a value of 10? Would it print 3? Would it be undefined behavior? I don't know. It's something that is not recommended because the behavior would be difficult to define. So it's something you can't support. You only can do this with effectively final or final variables. Similarly, another thing that you can't do with an anonymous inner class is you can't give it a constructor. And the reason for that is because since it's anonymous, what constructor name would you give it? I don't know. I mean, I could say my runnable, but how does Java know that that's the constructor? I could instead call it runnable, but in that case, I'm having a constructor for an interface, which doesn't make any sense. So really, you don't have the concept of a constructor within an anonymous inner class. If you want to have a constructor, then you need to have a regular inner class. What you can do, though, is let's say that you want to guarantee some sort of initialization in your anonymous inner class prior to calling any methods on it. If you recall from one of my previous videos, there's this concept of initializer blocks, those with object context and those with static context. Those are supported within anonymous inner classes. So in here, you could now initialize the state of your inner class if you wanted to make sure there were certain things set up so that your run method could use them. Let's say, for instance, that you wanted to have a custom variable, which starts out with a value of my variable, and then let's say you want to increment it by one, and then let's say that you want to divide it by two. Now you want to use custom variable in here rather than my variable. And I need to define it up here. Okay, that's better. All right, I'm doing a little math that the value starts out at 10. We add one and then we do integer division divided by two. That gets us back to five. So that looks better. All right, so that really covers the main things that you get with anonymous inner classes. Very useful when you want to restrict the scope of a class to a single usage. But their code footprint is still a little big, and that's where we'll get into lambda expressions in future videos, where we'll talk about how we can shrink that footprint even a little bit further if you have the special case of a functional interface. See, anonymous inner classes aren't too bad, right? Just think of it as an inner class that wants to stay anonymous. It doesn't want you to know what its name is. And that's fine, because it only has to be used once. So nobody else needs to know about it, right? I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you have any comments or anything you'd like to share, please do drop a comment below. Thank you as always for watching. I really appreciate it. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.